Hello, and welcome to the Blue Valley Educational Foundation's annual community breakfast. My name is Ellie Goldberg, and I'm an eighth grader at Leawood Middle School. Last year, my essay was chosen as Sunflower Ambassador winner for nominating a classmate who exemplifies the Blue Valley virtues. BVEF's Sunflower Ambassador program is a special character education program celebrating its 20th year and underwritten by Shawnee Mission Health. It recognizes students and staff members in each of our schools who are role models for others by living out the virtues of respect, responsibility, honesty, self-discipline, compassion, courage, and perseverance. Sunflower Ambassadors are nominated in essays written by their peers and selected from a panel of community leaders and educators. We are recognized at our individual schools in April each year and celebrated at the community breakfast. I am honored to be one of those students here this morning. Please enjoy your breakfast and this special ceremony with music provided by the Men's Chorus of Blue Valley West. Congratulations to all the 2017-2018 Sunflower Ambassadors. Making a difference begins with us.
And the moon is the only light we'll see.
No, I won't be afraid. No, I won't be afraid. Just as long as you stand by me.
So darling, darling, stand by me. Whoa, stand by me.
Oh, stand by me, stand by me.
If the sky that we look upon should tumble and fall, or the mountains should crumble to the sea,
I won't cry. I won't cry, no, I won't shed a tear. Just as long as you stand by me.
And darling, darling, stand by me. Oh, stand by me.
Oh, stand by me, stand by me.
We'll see.
No, I won't be afraid. No, I won't be afraid. Just as long as you stand by me.
And darling, darling, stand by me. Whoa, stand by me.
Oh, stand by me, stand by me.
If the sky that we look upon should tumble and fall, or the mountains should crumble to the sea.
I won't cry, no I won't shed a tear, just as long as you stand by me.
And darling, darling, stand by me, oh stand by me,
oh stand, stand by me, stand by me.
Ladies and gentlemen, one more round of applause for our 20th anniversary Sunflower Ambassadors and Men's Choir of Blue Valley West. Good morning and welcome to our 28th annual community breakfast. I am so grateful to all of you for being here to support our students, teachers, and schools. The level of commitment in this room is truly overwhelming, and from the bottom of my heart, thank you, thank you, thank you for supporting our community. My name is Joy Ginsburg, and I'm the Executive Director for the Blue Valley Educational Foundation. Our organization is focused on connecting the community to our schools and leveraging resources so our students can meet their full potential. We are determined to ensure our schools, our teachers, and our students have all the tools they need to ensure their success. And we couldn't do it without the support in this room. And behind every great organization are always amazing volunteers. I am so fortunate to work side by side with two amazing volunteers, both Blue Valley parents, both extremely committed to supporting our schools, and both who give back to Blue Valley at a level that cannot be measured. Please help me welcome BVEF's president and president-elect, Carol Sherman and Samantha Hammontree.
Thank you. Good morning, and I'll add my thank you for joining us this morning. Before I do anything else, I want to thank the committee, and especially Joy, Lisa, and Cindy for all their work, blood, sweat, and tears they did to make this a great day. So let's give them a big round of applause. The Blue Valley Ed Foundation Board is made up of individuals who spend a lot of time helping guide the organization to ensure our strategic direction is on track, our finances are sound, and our program activities and events are impactful. Members of our 2018-19 Board of Directors are listed on the screen, and I would like to ask each of them to stand and be recognized.
We would also like to take time to thank our sponsors for this event. It is hard to say enough about the support that we get from our title sponsor, Shawnee Mission Health. Shawnee Mission's health mission to focus on the whole person includes their commitment to keeping our schools strong and thus supporting our community at large. With their new facility in Overland Park, right behind the backyard of Blue Valley West, they offer 24/7 emergency room care and imaging center, Shawnee Mission primary care practice, cardiovascular, neurology, endocrinology specialists, PT Solutions, and a women's imaging center. Today, they have provided at this event three behavioral health experts who will be out in the hallways and available at the tables should you have any questions. A very special thanks to Shawnee Mission Health for your significant investment in our schools and our well-being.
And I'd like to recognize all of our Blue Valley schools. We have a unique partnership with our parent organizations in our schools, and every single Blue Valley school is represented here today. Their joint contribution adds up to $25,000. We greatly appreciate their support. Our underwriting sponsors this year include Durham School Services, Capital Federal Foundation, and Garmin. A special thank you to those three companies for their commitment to our schools.
We are very happy to add a few new sponsors to our investing sponsor level. Thank you to our returning sponsors, Main Street Credit Union, Major Saver, Bank of Blue Valley, Menorah Medical Center, and Smart Technologies. And welcome to our new sponsors, Price Brothers Management, Holmes Murphy, and NetSmart. Last but not least, we would like to recognize our Blue Valley School District Board of Education members. Would the Blue Valley School Board members please stand, especially our newest member, Amy Teisling, and be recognized. We are also very grateful to have many elected officials in the room with us today. The support of our public schools at all levels of government is critical, and we appreciate that so many elected officials have joined us. If you're an elected official, please stand to be recognized as well.
Early last school year, I wrote a letter to Blue Valley parents letting them know that BVEF was going to support the district priority of emotional well-being of our students. I told our parents that I, and many of our board members and district leaders, had become very concerned about our kids. We are worried about their social and emotional wellness, about how much pressure they are under, and how much anxiety they carry with them. I fear many of our children don't have the tools they need to cope with crisis, and we have been concerned that our parents also don't have the support they need to help their kids. So we have been taking action, and I mean action, and the focus of this breakfast is one more step to make sure we are talking to our community about how we can be part of the solution. It begins with us. It is going to take all of us to support our young people, and we look forward to continuing this important work with you.
Today, we're going to hear a lot about what we've done so far in the district and where we are headed. Together, we can make a difference, and we hope that you will join us. Now, please join me in welcoming to the stage a Blue Valley North junior and Kansas's Miss Outstanding team, Amelia Benjamin.
God bless America, land that I love. Stand beside her and guide her through the night with the light from above, from the mountains to the prairies. Mountains to the prairies to the oceans, wide with fire.
Nick and Jake's is named after our kids. Nick was my son, and Jake is our partner's son. When Nick passed, last year's tournament went to, we created Nick's Voice on the For the Kids golf tournament, and we raised about $450,000, and that money went to support Children's Mercy Hospital and Blue Valley School District's initiative of supporting the social worker program that was already in place with more of a psychiatric role. And if you've got a child with mental health issues, 3 months is unacceptable. So I think we've helped with that. What I love about the foundation is that we can raise money and specifically fill a need that a teacher has to help inspire children in their classrooms to learn. And that's really, as far as I'm concerned, what the foundation's all about, is how do we inspire, how do we motivate? And when teachers take the time out to write a grant that'll help their kids, sign me up. I wanna be there, I wanna help. Even though I haven't been on the board for the last couple of years, I'm still very engaged.
Good morning, everyone. My name is John Holt, Fox 4 News, purveyor of fake news nightly here in Kansas City. Note that that's Fox 4, and I'm sitting at table 41. Joy. Just kidding. It's great to be back with you all this morning at this community breakfast, and what an honor and a thrill for me to be here as a Blue Valley parent, first and foremost, two kids who were well prepared for what lie ahead of them when they went through the Blue Valley school system, first grade all the way through graduation at Blue Valley North. And also as a member of the very first class of the Best of Blue Valley Hall of Fame. And I must tell you, and Joy knows this, that when they reached out to me a year ago and let me know that I'd be so honored at last year's community breakfast, I'm like, what? Really? Moi? And I kept thinking of all the other people in this district who deserved to be in the Best of Blue Valley Hall of Fame, and I kept coming back to the young man I'm thrilled and honored to be here to introduce to you this morning, Kevin Timmons, who you just saw on that video. I mean, this guy means so much, not only to the district, but to the community at large. He's the ultimate yes man. KT, you don't know how to say no, do you? Yes, I'll be on the board. Yes, I'll serve as an MC. Yes, I'll help with a scholarship. And I've seen this one firsthand. Yeah, you know what? If these teachers will do this, I'll provide them lunch. Yes, yes, yes. And that's a good thing for all of us. And it's not just Blue Valley and the Educational Foundation and the school district. It's the community beyond that. He alluded to the loss of his son, Nick. A family hit with the ultimate tragedy, and very appropriate that we're here today to talk about the well-being of our students. They took that tragedy, formed Nick's Voice, and raised $450,000 to get it launched and to begin their work here in the school district through last year's For the Kids golf tournament. What you may not know is that that tournament, now in its 15th, 16th year, has raised more than $2 million for Children's Mercy Hospital, including that hospital just down the street. Amazing. But here's the best part. If you know Kevin Timmons, and I know so many of you do, you know KT, the fun guy who rides the school bus with me, and that's really how we bonded, not just in the bar. Real food, honest drink. But KT, just having fun, livening things up, walking into a room and having fun with the kids and the teachers. In fact, this is the KT we know and love right here, the big kid. There we are. How about that? Please say hello to your 2018 Hall of Fame inductee, Mr. Kevin Timmons. Kevin, come on up. Just a couple of big kids up there, buddy. Congratulations, well deserved.
Thank you. The 6 years I spent on the board serving the Education Foundation and serving the community, serving the kids, and most importantly, serving teachers that had an idea to better stimulate and educate their kids, and being able to help fund those ideas is really what's happening with all of you today in this room. And I just want you to know it's extremely rewarding for me, and I will continue on that mission. So if you're a teacher and you've got an idea and you wanna make something better in your classroom, let us know what it is and we'll work hard to help you attain that, okay? Thank you all, I appreciate this, it means a lot.
I'm a semi-retired MC of this event, as you can tell. It wasn't on the teleprompter, see? Actually, it's my honor to introduce to you a good friend of mine just down the street from our Fox 4 studios. He's an executive producer. You know him, you love him. Please say hello. And Blue Valley parent as well. Nick Haynes. Nick, come join us up here.
Everyone, at a time when they say there is a divide in this country, you have commercial television and public television on the same stage together, ladies and gentlemen. That is something incredibly special. What a wonderful, intimate gathering that we have. And thank you, if you were here last year, thank you for inviting me back. And I love the person who said, I love that guy. I love his accent. I could listen to him all day. And I could listen to him reading the phone book. And so, not to let people be disappointed, we're gonna start with Jay today, ladies and gentlemen. Alrighty. I am a parent of four children who have gone through or are still in Blue Valley schools. My daughter, who is 15 years old, I said last night, I'm gonna be speaking to your boss tomorrow. And she says, who's that? And I said, Dr. White, the superintendent. And she says, that's not my boss. I said, who is your boss? And she said, she doesn't have one. What is happening with kids today, ladies and gentlemen? Because for me, when Todd White, the superintendent of Blue Valley Schools, says jump, Nick Haynes says how high. He has the responsibility on his shoulders of 34 schools, more than 3,000 faculty and staff, more than 22,000 students. Please welcome to the stage your superintendent, Dr. Todd White. I told Dr. White last night when I spoke to him that I'm actually, this time next week, hosting the very first Kansas governor's debate. Can this be a dry run for that experience, Dr. White?
I don't know. I'm okay. Not sure we signed up for that.
But. You know, is being a superintendent a what have you done for me lately kind of a job? And if it is that, what have you done for us lately, Dr. White?
All right. He said he would ask me some pithy questions, so this might be the first one. You know, let me talk a little bit about what we did a year ago. And because some time has passed, and I'd like to not only tell you, but also our friends here today what we've done. You know, the academic achievement of our students is still a very high priority for us. And our ACT scores, as one element of that, is we continue to lead the nation and the state as being one of the premier districts in the United States. That's because you, as parents and community, send us a very good product. Secondly, we have some of the very best teachers and administrators in the world. Many of them are kind of sitting right over here, and by way of your applause, could you show your appreciation for what they do very much? You know, We continue to receive accolades, NCHC, best teachers, best district, our gold standard high schools. A year ago, we had 52 National Merit semifinalists. News just in today, 56 for this year. So it's great.
Now, last year, if you were here at this breakfast, it was a big headline at the time that the Blue Valley School District was opening a brand new Chinese immersion school. In fact, we had the principal right here, and she said at the time, yes, it's going to be amazing. Half the day is going to be in English, half the day is in Chinese. The Wolf Springs School by the Arboretum there in Southern Overland Park. What happened to that? Was it a good experience, or was it such a nightmare you said, we're going to convert it back to being a standard school, Dr. White?
No, it was a great experience. Our students, you can see some of the film there, had a wonderful experience. And we not only have Chinese immersion in Wolf Springs a year ago, we also had a Chinese class taught at Aubrey Bend Middle School and also Southwest High School. It went so well, we went back to our board, and the board said, let's expand it. So this year we have Chinese immersion in Valley Park Elementary, and at the middle school in Overland Trail and Blue Valley North. So we're expanding it. And we're also looking forward to expanding additional languages in future years for our immersion program.
So Welsh will be part of that, which is my own native land.
I think we might know somebody that could teach that.
Okay,
right?
All righty. Just recently, you were also in the headlines as the Blue Valley School District starts announcing that every high schooler in Blue Valley in the second semester will get an Apple MacBook, every middle schooler a Google Chromebook at a cost of around $8 million. Now, I will say, these stories have been around a while. I remember reporting on this about almost a decade ago that some school districts were doing this. So why now and what took so long?
Well, first of all, we wanted to study it.
Okay, all right.
Very well. And I think we did study it very well. We took a very thoughtful approach to this, and we called it an impact study. It included students, of course. It included teachers, administrators, but also included parents, because some of our students took the devices home. And after a period of time, we got back together and said, what did we learn? And part of that process through our blended learning department was to ask ourselves three very important questions. First of all, what is the instructional possibilities? Are they enhanced by the use of a technology device? Secondly, do we have the infrastructure to support the additional access and mobility that we would need? And thirdly, and most importantly, can we keep kids safe? And so we put all of that together in this study, came out with it. The results are very positive. And so as you indicated, beginning in January, our middle school students will receive a Chromebook for their work, and our high school students will receive an Apple Mac. And by spring break, or by March, we'll finish.
Are you concerned at all, though, about students losing these or damaging them?
No, I'm not. And quite honestly, part of that has been my experience in other districts in doing something similar, is that once you provide this as a vehicle that is meaningful for students in their work, they hang on to it. And they utilize it in such a way that everyone has one, and so it's a good opportunity. Speaking of March, you know, last year, March was a pretty cool opportunity for us to see some of our former graduates perform pretty well. You guys remember this? Yeah. So.
Speaking of March, last March was when we started seeing a lot of headlines about the Blue Valley School District. And those were the headlines about, is the Blue Valley School District going to be cutting out its arts programs? That was a Fox 4 headline. Can you believe that, the audacity? The Star sounded a similar alarm. Parents worry about future of arts as Blue Valley considers middle school curriculum changes. Did you remove music, art, band, choir from the middle schools, Dr. White?
No, we didn't. In fact, we brought a group of teachers and parents together to actually work through a process. It was never our intention to do that. But actually today, a new schedule is in place for all nine middle schools where students get more electives than they ever have and a fine arts of their choice. They don't get it every other day, they get it every day. So we've doubled down on our ability to provide enriching opportunities for our kids, particularly in the arts, which are critically important, and we've increased the instructional engagement time with our core teachers. So kudos to those teachers and parents.
If you were here at last year's breakfast, and many of you were, one of the big focuses was the fact that the Blue Valley School District, again, was making headlines at that time, adding 19 Children's Mercy social workers to schools because of concerns over the emotional well-being of students in the district. We didn't know when we met on the stage last year what was going to happen with that. What did happen?
Well, the results, as you see here, really kind of speak for themselves. I said last night at an event for Nick's Voice, I'm not sure how we did this work without their support. And what you see here is that in 1 year's time, 20 social workers contacted over 2,000 students, nearly 7,800 hours of intervention. And that one number might scare you, 544, you see that? Suicidal interventions. We knew that number would go up, and the reason is because we were creating access to service. That students have, honestly, some challenges, some things that they're dealing with, and we needed to provide an opportunity for that to be dealt with, and as well as their family, in a very important way. What you don't see here is how this value added the time for our counselors that are already doing great work, our school psychologists, our teachers, and our staff. So it's really been additive, and as you can see from the results of the survey that we did at the end of the year, people are really embracing the opportunity to have this sort of service and partnership, not only in our community, but certainly in their classrooms and in their schools. And I'll take 93% overall satisfaction any day.
You know, earlier this month, you were also in another major story in the Kansas City Star. Six school superintendents across Johnson County coming together to say enough is enough. They look at statistics that say teen suicide is up nearly double, actually, from the first 6 months of this year in Johnson County alone. What are you actually doing differently, though, Superintendent White?
Well, first of all, we are collaborating among the six school districts in Johnson County, which, quite honestly, when you think about the work that we do and the effort that we put forth in our community, a great deal of that is centric to our geographic location in the 35 or 45, if you're our neighbor to the north, and Mike Fulton and his district. But to really come together to have a common conversation about a situation that is dealing with us. Last year in Johnson County, we lost 15 students, five of which were Blue Valley. Enough is enough. We cannot continue to move forward with the understanding that this life that we have to offer, the opportunity for our students, cannot be fall short of that. And so we've come together in order to reduce silos, brought in faith-based partners, brought in mental health professionals in order to make sure that we can have a more collaborative conversation about it.
Can schools fix it alone? Joining us now are some key players who are actively engaged in rolling up their sleeves in this effort to try and make a dent out of the issue of anxiety, depression, suicide that we're seeing right here in the heart of our own community, and that's touching many of our lives. Joining us is senior pastor from one of our metro's largest congregations from just up the road at Church of the Resurrection, senior pastor and Blue Valley School District graduate, the Reverend Adam Hamilton. Thank you for being with us.
Hi.
Also with us is a parent who knows the anguish of working through mental health challenges with her own child, former elementary school principal, now the president of BV Well, Mandy Shoemaker. And as it's infuriating to have a conversation about our students and never actually include them, we have one from Blue Valley Northwest High School. Cynthia Dong is with us. She actually helped create a student-led mental health board at her high school. Cynthia, thank you so much for being with us. Reverend Hamilton, you've been in the preaching business for about a quarter of a century. I'm assuming when you started on that road, you weren't doing sermons about suicide and depression at that moment in time. Now you're doing it on a frequent basis. What changed?
Yeah, well, the increase in number of suicides, of course, has been dramatic.
We've had in the last 2 years 31 funerals for suicides at Church of the Resurrection. Most of those were not members. They were family members or people in the community, and we were caring for their families. But that's more than we had in the first 15 years of our church's history combined. And so the dramatic increase, and every time there's a suicide, there are 10 other people who are in that person's network of friends or family who now have in their mind, perhaps life gets so bad, this might be an option for me. Many of them will not think that, but at least a handful will. And so it sort of spreads. It's an epidemic.
Now, Mandy, you are the president of BV Well, and I know Blue Valley School District only puts out very judiciously about 29 emails a day, but there have been some about BV Well, but if you didn't catch that one, this is a brand new effort, a parent-led group to start tackling the issues of mental health, emotional well-being of students. What are you actually doing?
Yeah, well, our focus is educating and supporting parents as they navigate mental health and wellness with their children. And our focus is really on doing exactly that, helping support parents. We're putting on a speaker series. We have an educational component. We're screening films, just trying to get information into people's hands.
How do you know you're being effective? How will you know if you're being effective?
Well, at our first event, which was like February 14th, there were about 500 people. So I'm not sure that we can measure our effectiveness yet, but we certainly know there's a strong need in the community.
And Cynthia, at Blue Valley Northwest, you formed your own mental health board there. Why?
Well, I've always felt like mental health is something that I think in general we need more focus on. And at my school, we actually had a death related to suicide. And after that happened, I kind of realized that the students don't really have a way to talk to the adults in the building about what they want. And a lot of that isn't that the adults aren't doing anything about it. It's just that students are kind of uncomfortable talking to adults in that professional setting. So I started this mental health board so that students could have a voice in what they need for them to feel safe and loved in their own schools.
So you're doing all of that work. What has happened?
Well, we've been doing a lot of work. We had some student forums where we had people tell us what they want to see from Blue Valley Northwest. And we've been in contact with some district officials, and they've all been extremely responsive and receptive, and they've been taking measures to improve mental health care in our district, which I'm extremely grateful for. And we've also been trying to raise awareness within our school. We had Mental Health Week last year, and we talked about suicide prevention then. We talked about a couple other things. And this year, we're having another one, and we're talking about things like body image issues and de-stressing and suicide prevention, as well as mental health illness.
It's an important topic, but there's tons of talk, Reverend Hamilton. What do you actually do about it? And what, as one of our leading faith leaders and community leaders, does the community do about it?
Right. So at Resurrection, we decided we had to address this more, with a bit more passion than we had up to this point. So preaching about it, talking about it, even when we have funeral services, to be able to, the family members allow us to address this head on. In the middle of the service, you've got a room filled with people. Let's talk about why this is not the right answer. But so often we lose perspective, and that leads us to a place where we're not seeing or seeing the world clearly, so we need somebody to help us with perspective. We sometimes find ourselves withdrawing or alone, and we don't feel like we have people who are coming alongside us, and we lose hope. And so we have Thursday nights at Resurrection, we have Care Night, which is a night where we have hundreds of people gather, support groups, small groups of a variety of kinds, including those who are wrestling with depression, those who have survived suicide, that is family members who've survived, as well as persons who are wrestling with the thoughts related to suicide. So that's one piece of a whole.
I was reading the 15 questions that people who have been suicidal wish they had been asked. And at the very top of the list, number one, do you want to hang out? Is it just the presence of another person that is making the difference, Cynthia?
I really do think that, yes, I think showing a person who's struggling with those things that you care about them and that you need them is extremely important, because I've had my own personal experience with mental health illness, and I think that honestly, what they just want to hear is that someone is listening to them and someone's going to be there for them when they need it.
You're not off the hook, Dr. White, because in that story about the six school superintendents that were coming together to say enough is enough, I love to look at the comments that you see on these stories online. And there was a Ned from Kansas City who asked, are the school districts themselves contributing to the emotional distress teens are experiencing? He writes, intense pressure to gain high standardized test scores creates problems that touch every aspect of Johnson County educators today. Leaders need to own up to their own part.
Absolutely. That's one of the reasons why we've taken the approach to have a balance of academic pursuit, rigorous, relevant with regards to that, but also the whole child. That graphic that you saw about the middle school, right in the middle of it was the whole child element, which is the social and emotional aspects of the work that we do, but also of making sure that we just have health and wellness of the people that are in our system at the forefront of what we do. And in doing so, I think we create a balance where you can offer more rigorous, engaging opportunities, but because of the supports that you have, you're allowing that to occur naturally and with support.
What about the role of teachers in this? Wasn't there a Kansas law that was passed just quite recently, actually, that requires at least 1 hour of mandatory training of all teachers in the state of Kansas that will look at recognizing the symptoms of suicide? Is that happening?
Yes, it is. And it has for a while in our schools. So we're glad that we have some recognition of the importance of that. But it goes deeper than that. I think that what we are forming here is a culture of care, a culture of opportunity to listen and to engage our students and to let them know that, look, everybody has a bad day and it's just a bad day. There is a new beginning and a greater opportunity beyond that. But we also know that we're dealing with adolescents that are still forming those sorts of coping systems. And so that's part of our work to be able to do that. So you'll see this year an added emphasis for us to teach things like mindfulness, like a growth mindset, like grit, and those sorts of things, because we believe that those are skills that once adapted can help us cope, find relevance in our lives, but also make sure that they're worthwhile.
Now, five other superintendents are joining with you to try and work on the issue of suicide. In that article in the Star, there was one of the superintendents saying, we need to train parents how to talk to kids about suicide. What would that look like, Mandy?
Well, I think what we need to talk about first is the stigma. Because I think as parents and for the kids who are going through this, the stigma is the first barrier. So I think as parents, stopping judging each other as parents and looking maybe at a broader... at a broader description or acceptance of what what a grown Blue Valley product looks like. And so I think that looks like letting parents let go of some of that pressure. There is a lot of, for Blue Valley students, there's a lot of pressure, and for Blue Valley parents, there's a lot of pressure. So I think together, if we can take that on, we can let those conversations begin. And I have every faith in our parent community that they'll be great at those conversations when we're open enough to talk about them.
Look at surveys that ask teenagers why don't they talk to their parent about these issues, and the number one reason on that is two words, Cynthia. They freak out, okay? They dismiss it. They don't say, oh, you're not suicidal. They deflect that and think you're just looking for attention. It's about something else. Isn't it hard for students to actually talk to their parents about these issues?
Yes, 100%. The first time I actually talked to my mom about this, she also, for lack of a better term, freaked out. So I think that the main thing that's happening is that there's a lot of discomfort around talking about mental health, even between like a parent and a child. And I think that it's important to realize that you don't have to understand what your child is going through the moment they tell you. I think that you just need to be there for them and provide them the support they need, and to actively try to learn from them and help them get better. And that it's okay not to know, because you know your child probably doesn't know what they're really going through either, and they're coming to you because they want your help and support.
Mandy mentioned that the very first meeting of BV Well, what surprised them was the fact that 500 people, even though KCPT at that night was showing the hibernation patterns of the brown bear, primetime special on nature, they had 500 people. Kind of amazing. But how do you do that, Cynthia, at the school level? Most students are not going to be interested in this topic, right?
Well, I would kind of disagree there, actually. Okay. I think that for the majority of students, mental health is a very prominent topic in their day. And even if we don't always talk about it because of the stigma around it, it's something that everyone is thinking about. I mean, my personal experience with it is I think a lot of students around me are extremely stressed. And I think part of it is just because of how much pressure they put on themselves to achieve. And I think that culture needs to change. And so I think that, you know, there's actually a lot more interest than you might think at first.
My concern is, Reverend Hamilton, that part of this is to do with the fact that if I sought help, what difference would it make? Having an hour in a counseling session, how does that help me if I'm at school and I'm feeling marginalized, or I'm being bullied, or I see other people living in these huge houses and they've got all the brand name label clothing and I don't? That's not changing as a result of me going to a session with a counselor, right?
Yeah, well, one session with a counselor is probably not going to be the sole solution, so that might be the beginning of a whole lot more. And you're right, there's between the bullying that goes on at times, the sense, you know, there are a host of things that contribute to the sense of hopelessness. Life is never going to get any better. I don't know how I'm going to make it through this. And the loss of perspective, in which I can't really see beyond my present circumstances. And this again goes to having people, being able to talk about it, having people who surround you and are able to say in a calm, reassuring way, not the freaking out way, you know what, we're going to make it through this. I'm with you. I care about you. And this could be a teacher. It could be a counselor. It could be a pastor, a youth pastor, family member, a friend. But that ongoing, we're going to make it through this. Let's, you know, and the ability to not only demonstrate care and non-anxiety, but also a sense of hope. There is hope. We're going to make it through this, and there is a sense of hope.
Did you want to respond to that, Dr. White?
I did. And what I wanted to say is what Adam just said is exactly where our teachers and our administrators are, is that they are that hope. They are that listening ear. They are that comfort in a time that is discomfort. And each and every one of our classrooms and our schools will be that safe place for them where we can both listen, we can collaborate, and we can help, and we can grow together.
Mandy?
I think one of the things that really struck me that you said is that kids don't talk to their parents because they're afraid they're going to freak out. And that is really one of our focus areas for BV Well. And I'll give a little plug for an event that we have coming up in October. October 10th and 11th, we are bringing a father-son group, Kirk and Casey Martin, who are part of an organization called Celebrate Calm. And that's exactly what their work is focused on, is helping parents develop relationships with their kids of all ages, elementary through high school, and how do we develop relationships in which we have the kind of communication where we can deal with the everyday troubles and we're prepared to calmly handle a crisis. So that's October 10th and 11th.
The other thing that's come up on this is that one in five people who do take their own lives, Reverend Hamilton, have sought mental health and so it help, and so it gets the impression that somehow we can't do much to change this. If somebody is really suicidal, what can we do as a school district, as a student mental health board, as a parent, as a congregation, to change somebody's feelings?
Well, I want to say, this is a segue to say something else, maybe answer a different question, but I was on the San Francisco Golden Gate Bridge a couple of years ago on vacation, and my wife and I were walking across, there's signs all over the place, please call suicide hotline, because the number of people who have jumped off the Golden Gate Bridge. I found a police officer there, and I wanted to just ask him a couple of questions. I said, you know, what are you doing out here? I knew what he was doing. He said, my job is to constantly be scanning and watching and to keep them from jumping. And I said, have you ever lost someone? And he said, yes, on multiple occasions I have. And I told our congregation, you can have all of it. He's had specialized training as a police officer. His sole job is to watch for people jumping off the bridge, and there's still going to be some who are going to jump, and he's not going to get to them. And when we think about the number of folks, we all know people who've lost a child to suicide. And it's easy for people to be wrestling with guilt. It's friends, family. If I'd only done this, if I could have done that. The reality is if somebody's perfectly trained and knows all the things to watch for and they can't catch them all, there are going to be times where we'll wish we'd said one more thing and we couldn't have. Or there are times we've done everything. I was with a family not long ago. They had done everything that you could do. But if this person is determined and often it is related to mental health and wellness and depression, deep depression, it is not your fault that you were not able to stop them. You tried and you did everything you could. Having said that, I'm so grateful for Superintendent White and others saying we can do more, what Mandy's doing and what others are doing. And what I love here in this room is there are parents of children who took their own lives, who said, we're going to take this as an opportunity to help other people. The Harrells are here, and Kevin and others who've said, out of our pain, we're going to do everything we can to increase the resources. So when you do experience this kind of tragedy, then your question is, what can I do now? But I want to reiterate, this morning I was just in an email with somebody who lives in another state emailing me, and I could tell they were at that same place, and it's still, look, let's get together and talk. You're going to make it through this. This is going to be, you can make it through this. It's going to be okay. I promise you, on the other side, we're going to make it through this. So, anyway.
Cynthia, you were in the Blue Valley Northwest student newspaper, and you were open about your own struggles with anxiety and depression starting at the middle school years. Back to what Reverend Hamilton said, is there anything that somebody could have said to you that would have made a difference?
Well, actually, someone did say something to me that made a difference. So,
what was that?
I remember in seventh grade when I was having a really bad day, my science teacher took me outside of the classroom and she asked me, are you doing okay? Like, how are you? And I said, oh, I'm doing fine. And she said, no, you need to tell me the truth right now. And so she listened to me and I told her, I'm not okay. I really need someone to help me. And she hugged me and she told me, you deserve to be happy. You deserve to have all the things you have in life.
How did that make you feel? Did you think, oh, back off, I don't want to go through this? Or were you appreciative of a teacher going beyond that first easy question?
I think initially I was a little bit annoyed because I was
absolutely.
Like, what do you know about me? But I think, looking back at it, I think that it was the right thing to do, and it definitely helped me realize that there are so many reasons to live life, and there are so many amazing things that you'll miss out on if you don't.
Dr. White?
Well, I would just say that I think that science teacher is one of many that we have, both in our community, but also in the profession. The thing that I would like to make sure that we insert into the conversation is the health and well-being of those people that are taking care of others. And it's important for us as an organization in the district to make sure that we take care of our teachers and our staff members and our principals that are on the front lines every day embracing these sorts of opportunities. So when we say health and well-being, when we say that we're connecting with the whole child, we're not leaving our staff out. They're the centerpiece of that. I tell the story that all of us have gotten on a plane know that there are safety procedures that they talk about as we do that. And one of those that we really don't think about but is said every time is that if there's a drop in cabin pressure, oxygen masks are going to fall out of the ceiling and you're to put those on. And there's a sentence at the end of it that is critically important that speaks to this point. If you are riding with a child, make sure that you put the mask on yourself first. In order for us to take care of our children best, we also need to take care of ourselves and those that are providing that care. And that's our number one priority as well.
I was listening to a mental health professional who said, some experts, we can't solve the teen suicide problem. We can only work on it. The Blue Valley School District working on it. Cynthia Dong, Reverend Hamilton, Mandy Shoemaker, thank you so much for being with us. You stay here for a moment, Dr. White. I still have some words for you.
One more pilthy.
We appreciate
question.
Them, ladies and gentlemen, joining us this morning.
Great job. Thank you.
As we continue with our community breakfast. Thank you. This is an example. This is an example where the school district has to react to things in the community,
right.
Often crisis situations beyond your control that you have to respond to. And that's true of other areas. As a superintendent, you're also having to respond to things like school funding that might be out of your control, but then you have to finally get inserted into that. It's one thing after another, putting a fire out. Do you actually have dreams for this district when you're not putting out those fires?
Absolutely. I appreciate you asking the question, actually, because over the last 3 years, we've talked a lot about dreaming in the district, because I believe that dreams are what make possibilities come to reality. And this past year, in fact, when I was talking with our staff at Convocation, I said the Tuesday before school started on a Wednesday, we had 22,000 students that went to sleep that evening, and I wonder what their dream was about this coming year. The hopes, maybe the fears, the anxiousness, but I'm pretty sure we had 22,000 dreams being dreamt. I know that for the 3,000 staff members that we had, we also had dreams of hope and challenge and opportunity, that sort of thing. Parents certainly went to bed that evening with a great deal of hope and anticipation. As a grandparent of three Blue Valley students, I also did, and I think our community does as well. You know, when you kind of add all of that up, there's probably a million dreams that were dreamt about hope, about opportunity for us. And in the Blue Valley schools, dreaming that dream is our greatest opportunity because, in fact, it truly does begin with us.
Thank you very much, Dr. White.
I close my eyes and I can see a world that's waiting up for me that I call my own. Through the dark, through the door, through where no one's been before, but it feels like home.
I really like helping people.
They can say it all sounds crazy. They can say I've lost my mind.
How am I feeling? I'm very happy.
I don't care, so call me crazy. We can live in a world that we desire.
It is an honor for me to teach here.
Cause every night I lie in bed, your brightest colors fill my head. A million dreams are keeping me away.
Surprise!
I think of what the world could be, a vision of the one I see. A million dreams is all it's gonna take.
Custer.
A lot of the credit goes to Coach Fritz for me and Ben, just because he taught us how to play the game the right way.
Even having Coach Serbo, having Coach, you know, Riker, guys like that, like football coaches in the weight room, like just having a lot of people hold you accountable.
With things from far away, special things I compile, each one there to make you smile on a rainbow. Say it all sounds crazy. They can say we've lost our minds. I don't care if they call us crazy. Run away to a world that we desire.
Every night I lie in bed, the brightest colors fill my head. A million dreams are keeping me away. I think of what the world could be, a vision of the one I see. A million dreams is all it's gonna take.
Oh, a million dreams for the world we're gonna make.
However big, however small, let me be a part of it all. share your dreams with me. You may be right, you may be wrong, but see that you'll bring me along to the world you'll see, to the world I close my eyes to see, I close my eyes to see. Every night I lie in bed, the brightest colors fill my head. A million dreams are keeping me awake. I think of what the world could be, a vision of the one I see. A million dreams is all it's gonna take. Oh, a million dreams for the world we're gonna make. For the world we're gonna make.
Mia Cabrera. Wow. Thank you so much. And I'm supposed to follow that. So now it's time to ask for the money. And that's why I'm here. We've talked a lot about the best of Blue Valley today. We've talked about the us. And so I want to give you just a little bit of insight into my life. Before I do that, I have to tell you that I'm a crier. So this is going to be 50-50 whether I can do this or not. But, you know, a lot of people bring an emotional support animal with them when they got to do this stuff, and I didn't have one, so I brought an emotional support personality. So John Holt is going to help me stay on track. So John, come up here. John knows I'm a crier, and so if I start to cry, John's going to keep me on track with a finger point. And then I want to say thank you also to Shawnee Mission Health for all the tissues that are on your tables. You may need those as I talk here.
Hey, how you doing?
Oh, I'm good. I may need that water. Just this year, I learned more than I ever thought that I would about the importance of us and the community support and why it's important. The panel really went far deeper into the subject than I could have thought, but it sparked for me the difficulty of transition from high school to college for many of our kids. And in this, I'm talking about my daughter, Abby. How am I doing? Okay, good. Our kids are under a lot of pressure. They think there's only one road to get through life. They think our society believes that everyone should fit into a one-size-fits-all lifestyle. Pressures to have lots of friends, make perfect grades, to know what you want to do when you grow up. There's pressure to be invited to every party, take AP classes, be good in a sport, be good in music, have it all together. This was not my child. She realized after a difficult first year of trying college that the traditional path might not be for her. And after a lot of tears and a lot of discussion and help from a community, Mom and I helped her realize that that traditional path might not be where she was going to go. We wanted her to, oh my God, they just put her on the screen. We wanted her to be supported and be successful in the things that she could be successful at. You see, it's important for our kids to get the support that they need and make the decisions that are right for them, not the life plan that our society has laid out for them. I couldn't possibly tell you all the individuals that helped us get to the decisions that we made, There were many, including one business owner in our community that gave Abby a job that she really loves, working with kids. And before I came up to do this, I asked Abby, should I do this? And she said, Dad, if it will help someone else, you should do this. So today is your opportunity to help someone else. As you've heard, we can make a difference in our students' lives. We can help change their roadmap, support them in ways that maybe we hadn't thought of before. We all love our children, and we want what's best for them. Today, I'm going to ask you to donate to the Blue Valley Education Foundation's goals of supporting overall student well-being. BVEF is committed to supporting our schools through social-emotional learning programs, suicide prevention programs geared to improving resiliency, and helping students bridge from life at home to the real world. They're lofty goals, but you can help us make that a reality. And today we want to send a message to our kids that our schools care, that we support them in whatever way that is. We make up their us. You helped make up my us. So everybody pick up your cell phone. This is going to be the one time you're going to be in a meeting like this and you can text and it's okay. On your phone, you can text in all caps, BVEF, to the number 243-725. It's that simple. In the message box, just test those four letters. Now, some of you may be technology challenged. There's probably a fifth grader at a table near you who could do it for you. Or you can pick up the envelopes that are on your tables and you can make a donation today. Right now, in this room, right now, today, is when you can have the biggest impact. No donation is too large or too small. Please listen carefully. We want everyone here to have an opportunity to participate and give. While you're texting and you're giving the resources for those students to have the help and support that they need, we're going to listen to the girls' quartet singing You Can Count on Me. So let's make them count on us.
Yourself stuck in the middle of the sea, I'll sail the world to find you. And if you've ever find yourself lost in the dark and you can't see, I'll be the light to guide you. We find out what we're made of when we are called to help our friends in need. You can count on me like 1, 2, 3. I'll be there. And I know when I need it, I can count on you like 4, 3, 2. You'll be there. 'Cause that's what friends are supposed to do, oh yeah. Ooh. Yeah, yeah. If you're tossed and turned and just can't fall asleep,
you ever forget how much you really mean to me, every day I will remind you. Find out what we're made of when we are called to help our friends in need. You can count on me like 1, 2, 3, I'll be there. And I know when I need it, I can count on you like 4, 3, 2, you'll be there. That's what friends are supposed to do, oh yeah. Ooh, ooh, yeah, yeah. You'll always have my shoulder when you cry. I'll never let go, never say goodbye. You'll be there. 'Cause that's what friends are supposed to do, oh yeah. Ooh, ooh, you can count on me, 'cause I can count on you.
Dramatic pause for effect. Thank you so much. That was fantastic. Well, we're getting there. 16,499. Okay, so we have good news. Keep the Spark Alive Foundation is planning to partner with Blue Valley and Speak Up to match dollar for dollar any donations up to $30,000. Today, Keep the Spark Alive and Speak Up are committed to helping the Blue Valley Schools support our students, and their donation will help fund a peer-led suicide prevention program called Success of Strength. Let's match their $30,000 and find more programs that will impact overall students. And folks, we're so close. Let's don't leave that money on the table. There's people in this room who can make us get there quickly and make it happen. So keep doing it. Keep texting. Thank you so much for coming this morning and supporting. Also, if you're going to make your donations by your envelopes, if you want to hold up your cards, we will have volunteers come around to your table and pick those up from you if you would rather do it. So get them up in the air. And thank you. And let me make sure that I'm not missing anything else. Okay. I think I'm good. Thank you.
Have you ever felt like nobody was there? Have you ever felt forgotten? In the middle of nowhere, have you ever felt like you could disappear? Like you could fall and no one would hear?
So let that lonely feeling wash away. 'Cause maybe there's a reason to believe you'll be okay. 'Cause when you don't feel strong enough to stand, you can reach out your hand. And oh.
and I know we'll take you home. Even when the dark comes crashing through, when you need a friend to carry you, and when you're broken on the ground, you will be found. So let the sun come streaming in, 'cause you'll reach up and you'll rise again. Lift your head and look around. You will be found. You will be found. You will be found. You will be found.
You will be found.
Say the word. From across the silence, your voice is heard.
Oh. Someone will come running.
Oh.
To take you home.
When you need a friend to carry you, when you're broken on the ground, you will be found. So let the sun come streaming in, you'll reach up and you'll rise again. If you only look around, you will be found.
You will be found.
When you're broken on the ground, you will be found.
Let the sun come streaming in,
'cause you'll reach up and you'll rise again. If you only look around, you will be found.
Let the sun come streaming in,
you will be found.
Someone
to carry you. You will be found.
Join me in thanking the Blue Valley High Chamber Singers, directed by Marshall Moeller. You're amazing. The talent we have within our schools is so unbelievable, and I'm so happy that we were able to expose you to just a little bit of that today. I am just blown away by the support we got in this room this morning. We have only just begun to make a difference in our students' lives, and I hope this event sticks with you for a while after it's over. It Begins With Us was a theme that meant a lot to us. We know no one can do it alone, and we are very proud that this group here today is part of our us. We would like your help to spread the word, and we want you to take your centerpieces with the bases back to your offices and schools. We are all in this together, and we hope that you will find a place to display our students' artwork around the city to let others know that you are part of us. We're also planning to display the huge us that hopefully many of you signed at the district office and at our events throughout the year. A very special thanks to vendor Roger Hayes with Precision Craft for producing those for us. They will be very well used this year. And because we never sleep at BVEF, I want to quickly announce a few upcoming events. January 19th will be our 8th annual Battle of the Bands event. This event helps raise funds for our Band Together program, an initiative to ensure all students have access to musical instruments. Our honorary chairs, Kansas City Chiefs Trent Green and his wife Julie, and celebrity MC Joel Goldberg, will be back at this awesome event. And we'll be doing a BMW raffle again, courtesy of Barron BMW, so you won't want to miss it. Sponsorship opportunities are available, hint, hint. This spring, we'll also have our 3rd annual Night of Lights event, which is a family-friendly festival celebrating all the great things happening in Blue Valley. More to come on that event soon. Right outside the ballroom, Shawnee Mission Health behavioral health specialists are at a table to answer questions. We know that this event focused on emotional issues, and we are so thankful to Shawnee Mission Health for offering to support our guests following the event. Please visit their table outside. And if you still have a donation envelope, we will have folks at the door to pick them up. BVEF has just begun to make real positive strides towards ensuring emotional and social resources are available for all of our students, teachers, and parents. We are so happy you're part of us. Thank you again for being here this morning. Until next year, be well.